Afternoon, everyone. Happy Friday. It is Friday the 1st of March, 2019. I'm Kevin. You're watching Working to Relax. So today, I guess the week's gone off kind of weird and kind of rocky, hilly, kind of up and down. And my unit for Wednesday that I had to get done had a, I think I talked about this one last year, had a pencil size hole in the gas line for the fridge on the slide out. It was rubbing on the tire. And then I got that fixed in a Hail Mary and got it out on time still. I actually canceled the walkthrough. The salesman canceled it and was pushing it off to as soon as we could get it fixed so you could take it. And I got it done in time still. So that was kind of a nice Hail Mary. It felt good. Got two units in from a factory manufacturer. It's a small company just starting out. Not really liking how they handle things within it's not service so much. I know that I struggle with, being criticized and things like that. And, sometimes you have to take criticism. I may not like what people have to say, but, given some time and some thought, I can come around to what they were saying, and maybe agree. I am pretty bullheaded, but this outfit here, they just don't like any criticism whatsoever of their coaches. I mean, I made a comment. They had this really neat-looking little 17-foot trailer. It's only 13-foot box, 17-foot tongue-to-bumper, or tongue-to-back. Well, it doesn't have a bumper. And it's really a neat concept camper. Very expensive. Their 25-foot model is about 50 grand, like 49.9, like 50 grand. The 13-foot or 17-foot model, same thing, is probably somewhere in that neck of the woods. It's all composite material, all made in-house stuff. There's not a lot of outsourced parts per se. Everything's made in-house, except for some of the vendor parts like appliances and whatnot. But the coach itself is all built in-house with their own designs and stuff. And it was really a neat little setup. It had a front kitchen right across the front. You walked in the doors at the front, and as you walked in, there was your fridge on your right, your stove, your sink, a little counter. It's still a pretty functional, small kitchen for somebody that wants to be like a minimalist or just wants to camp and wants a, obviously you want a kitchen. As you walked in the entry door, on the left was your TV on the wall to your left. And this nice little, like a hutch almost, something like you'd see at your, you might have at home or something like that, A couple of shelves down below and then the TV up top, and it had some nice crown trim on it. The back of the coach had a 13-foot, had a nice, big, huge bathroom. And you're probably picturing your mind going, well, this is a tiny coach for 13-foot. Let me tell you what, the slide out, that was the sofa that slid out, and it was a kind of like a, not quite a Murphy bed concept, but it's a height of bed that flips out, and basically you have a residential mattress on it. That with the slide out opened, it gave you 11-foot. So the camper overall is about 11 foot wide by 13-foot long. That's not including the length of the slide. But like I said, with that slide out open, it was a huge area. And they had this table for, kind of something you can just put away. If you didn't want to use it, you didn't have to. But to me, for the money that you're paying for this coach, the dinette table should be some kind of functional. But they gave you these two real nice, they look chintzy, as in lightweight. Not cheap, but lightweight. They were wooden chairs. They were dinette chairs, and they folded flat, and they stored against the wall. Had a nice strap system that held them back. And then it had this nice, solid wood table that would slide into the hutch for the TV. And it would hook in, and then it, you had a spot for your table, but it had one leg that slipped down. So when it hooked in under the hutch, you lost about, maybe that much depth of the count of the table. And the table's probably waist high standing on end, And so you lost about that much, maybe 8-10 inches, maybe a little more of the table. So the table got a little bit shorter, which isn't a bad thing. I mean, it is a small camper made for one or two people. But once you got past that, once you put the table up, I didn't care for the floor plan anymore, because if someone is in the kitchen cooking, and again, this is a coach probably meant for one, maybe two, maybe you have a dog, but to me, when you put the table up in that position, Again, because it's hooked under the TV. So as you walk in, you have your fridge, stove, and sink on your right. But then on your left, you've got the dinette sticking out now that's covering about two-thirds of the trailer, maybe, or so. Maybe that's a little over-figuring, but, you know. And then with a chair on the end, now you're walking all the way to the couch to walk around to go to the bathroom. So my thought is no, that I don't like that. That to me is a very dumb layout. At that point, the table killed it for me. I wouldn't spend the money on it. However, when I mentioned it to the guy, and I didn't mean to come across nasty, but my comment was, that 17-foot, boy, is it really neat. And it is. It is a very neat floor plan. There's a lot in a very small space. And it's big for being small. You can actually take care of all your business in the bathroom very comfortably without it being an issue. And again, the kitchen's very functional. Good amount of storage, lightweight, single axle. You know, all that good stuff. Real nice power awning with no arms. All the arms are built into the awning, so nothing comes down. It's all in the fabric and everything, basically. Really, really nice unit. But the table killed it for me. So my comment was, hey, you know, that 17-foot is really neat, but that dinette's kind of dumb. So maybe that was the wrong way to put it, but just speaking my mind. Sometimes I guess maybe I'm a little too blunt. I don't know. You tell me. But, so, he says to me, well, if you know, if you got a better idea, well, you come up with something. And I said, well, I do have a better idea. I said, how about putting a set of folding legs in the bottom of that table? Because then, in my thought, the table can go anywhere. You know, you could put it there if you want it there. You could turn it sideways, you know, and not have it sticking out like that. You could block part of the way instead of all the walkway. The other thing was, you know, people have friends and people travel, company, kids, grandkids, whatever. You know, maybe you got friends that are camping with you, next to you, and you're going to have them over for dinner. Maybe it's raining. Guess what? If you got a table with legs like that, you can slide it over to the sofa. Two people can sit at the couch, and two people can sit in the chairs on the other side. Now, you got seating for four in a coach that's only 13 foot long. Now, that to me seems smart. My other thought is, I've been to campgrounds where I don't have a picnic table. So I have, in my baggage compartment, I have a table that I have to pull out and put together, you know, do my thing, whatever. And I got chairs I pull out and this and that. And I've got the storage to do it, but I am carrying more things with me. However, if you flip this around and you had a table with legs that folded under, like a folding table, you could take the table outside. Because you don't have a dinette, or a picnic table. So you take the table outside. And because of that, guess what? They gave you two chairs that, again, store neatly against the wall with the table. So now you have two chairs and a table outside. Gee whiz. That seems to me to be kind of a multitasking, like a multi-purpose, multifunctional dinette. You know? That would store away in the same spot you had it, but it's multifunctional. Same size table. I'm not saying make it bigger, make it smaller. But you got different legs on it. And now it's, again, multifunctional. I'm sorry. So apparently, I think I struck a nerve. Every time I talk to this company, I think I struck a nerve. They insist they don't need any weight distribution hitches on their trailers. And I think it's because their campers aren't designed for it. Because it's a carbon fiber tongue. And I want to say that tongue is about 4x4 square tubes, and they're thick. They're not thin, they're thick. But, you know, they're still like 300 to 400, maybe 500 pounds of tongue weight. The big one, anyways. And my thought was, is if you hook that to, and they've got video of their big 25-footer on the back of a new Ford Explorer, and the vehicle is riding level. Fairly level. And the camper is too. Now, my grandfather has a 2017 Chrysler Pacifica. He bought the first model year out. Okay. And we put a hitch on the back of his van for my grandmother's electric scooter that they bought for her. Because in her age, you know, she's had back surgery and stuff. She has a hard time getting around. So, you know, when we go places together as a family, like if we were to go to Disney or any kind of a function where you have like a craft show or something like that, they don't have to rent one. They own one. So to get it around, Grandpa put a hitch on the van, and then we got the rack just slide in, and then it flips up. And I talked him out of aluminum, and maybe I shouldn't have, but I talked him into the steel one, and then because it's heavier duty in my book, but I mean, you know, at his age, maybe we should have went aluminum, but it was a lot more money too. So I mean, the cost difference was like, well, if Grandma don't like this, you spend a lot of money and we're screwed. But you know, if you spend a little less money, then she does like it. You know, I don't know. It's kind of a bad way out. But anyways, so getting on with that, when we put that on the van, it ain't light. So the van probably drops at least 2 to 3 inches. And I'm going to guess that that's got to be at least 200 pounds worth of steel. Is it, like I said, it ain't light. I'm going to guess that you're pushing maybe 150. But if you do that, then I sit on it, and I'm 300 pounds. And the scooter and I weigh about the same. You put that on the back of the van. Now the van is literally at its lowest point. It's on its overload, you know, joust bumpers, whatever you want to call them. And the van really don't ride for shit then. Because the back end's squatting, so the front end's raising up. So the front suspension's fully stretched, so the wheels are, you know, instead of being parallel, the wheels are more like, you know, something along that nature. And then the back wheel, as you can see, they're kind of tucked in like this on the back end, because it's all independent suspension on that Pacifica. So, and I'm not knocking the van, but my thing is this coach is designed around the fact that you can pull it with a Chrysler Pacifica, a Ford Explorer, a Santa Fe, you know, a Honda Pilot, you know, the Honda Odyssey minivan. I've seen 10-foot pop-up campers, just simple basic pop-up campers, make a minivan squat. And they ain't got squat for tongue weight. They really don't. 300 to 400 pounds, maybe. So again, I'm trying to get through this this manufacturer. Well, you've got to have some kind of an ultimatum for people that have lighter suspension vehicles, because if you get the 25 footer, which does sleep four, so you could have a mom and dad and two kids, and it would be very adequately comfortable. And the kids would have a good bed to sleep on. That dinette's very big when it's down as a bed. I can sleep on it. I'm 6'1". I could lay on it. But the trouble is if your vehicle rides down here and the camper rides way up here, you know, your hitch is down here, I should say, and your trailer coupler's up here. And this is like a dramatization, because I mean, in reality, you're probably talking, you know, probably 2 foot, 1.5 foot difference maybe. Before the ball comes out. So by the time you have a hitch come out and up, you drop it onto the vehicle, you know, my thinking is that, you know, car, trailer, by the time you raise it up, put it on the ball, and you squat it, you're going to be riding like this with your vehicle. Okay, now there's no way I can get my grandfather out here to try it on his minivan. But just for shits and grins. But I'm pretty sure that when I checked last, I think his Pacifica was rated for something around 5, maybe 6,000 pounds, maybe. And I'm probably wrong on the 6. To tow. Because we had looked into a travel trailer for him before, and I had found one that was like 3,500 pounds, something like that. A little J-Flight SLX, little single axle little guy. Low to the ground, narrow, short little camper, something they could have managed real easily, but different story. But anyways, so their thing is they don't need weight distribution. They've designed their coach with the proper amount of percentages and stuff, so that the axles are positioned in the exact right spot, so that no matter what you do, as long as the customer loads the camper correctly and the vehicle, they will maintain their proper right height. I don't know a customer yet that's loaded their camper properly in my entire life. Even I don't have mine loaded properly, I'm sure. I've got the pass-through storage in my trailer, and I have 2 totes, a toolbox. I know there's some other blocks of wood in there. The 2 totes, one of them is all my hoses and cords. One of them is nothing but blocks of wood. And I'm talking the square rectangle totes. The other one's got my hoses and stuff, and then my toolbox. There's quite a few odds and end things. And the front of our trailer is a bedroom. So you have the 2 closets and then the cabinets above. So maybe we're not too bad tongue-wise. Our kitchen is just in front of the axles, so the refrigerator is actually above half of the front wheel, and then across from that is the stove, the sink, the water heater, the furnace, which again is all forward of the wheels. My fresh water tank is in front of the wheels. The kitchen cabinets and stuff are full. And over the slide out, you have all your cabinets there that are full. And then the ones above the dinette. You go back, you have the bunk bed on the bottom. Well, that's all full. So, I mean, it's probably packed properly, you know, the way it probably should, I'm guessing. We've weighed the trailer, and the weights don't come out bad. The tongue weight's fine, and so is the overall axle weight. Each wheel's carrying the same, within a few pounds of one another, the same amount of weight. And, you know, I'm going to say that mine's probably balanced pretty fair to what it should be. But, again, I don't know too many people that actually load them properly. I know full-timers that are without water are at the max of the axles of the trailer itself's gross vehicle weight, whatever it can, the camper plus its cargo, that are right there nipping at it, and they're trying to get rid of crap and downsize so that they can have more leeway so they can put water in the trailer and not bend their axles or hurt their truck or their hitch in their truck. So, I mean, you know, come on. So anyway, so they get a little bit, I think this company gets a little bit butthurt when I mention these things. I shouldn't say butthurt, but they just don't like the criticism at all. So it is what it is. If you don't like it, I'm sure somebody else has brought it up to them before me. Even sway control. They don't want any sway control. I'm sorry. You're scaring me. Little bitty campers, I'm sorry. I've pulled little single axle trailers behind my truck, and they handle for shit. My utility trailer handles nice, but it doesn't weigh anything. I can push it around real easy, you know. But a travel trailer, I've pulled little ones the size of my utility trailer, maybe a little bit longer. Maybe about that 17-footer, maybe a little bit longer. And they don't handle for crap. If it's a windy day, and I'm not talking excessive wind, I'm just talking a windy day. They just don't pull for crap. You really need some kind of friction sway of some kind to keep it straight. You know, I just don't see their camper being any different from anybody else's manufacturer. So there's that. Then, I kind of ticked off another customer, and I wasn't trying to. I was really trying to help the guy. I knew him from when he bought the camper from the place I work now. I was working part-time at the time. And they were in a pinch. They needed some help getting some things done because they were swamped. And I had, you know, the experience. And they had some things that were over their head, so I helped them. And then once the guy took delivery of the camper and it went to his campground, because we delivered it apparently to his campground, we delivered it in this endless spot, whatever, and set it up, and then he built a deck onto it. There were some problems with it very early on, and little things, you know, nothing that hindered the camper's function. I guess something with a stove burner caught on fire, and it was a cobweb, which means that our guys didn't PDI it properly, but that's not my fault. But that was taken care of easily, and he was complaining about the stovetop paint being burnt. And when I got it, I couldn't find anything wrong with it. I really couldn't. So I wound up taking the cover and swapping it with a stock unit and taking a brand new one. The entry door was damaged due to vandalism on our dealership lot before we bought it. So the new door came in, and I took it out there and I installed it for him. And I wasn't prepared with all the right tools to do it. So I had what I thought I needed, and this is everything that the guy at the dealership gave me, but as it turned out, no. I didn't have the right decals, I didn't have caulking to caulk it, I didn't have nothing. So he told me I didn't need it. I got there, the other door was caulked all the way around it. So there's nothing I could do. So the guy had a list of complaints of more things, so I had to take them all down, look at everything, diagnose it, write it down, take the list back, give it to the guy at the dealership. He was supposed to get the parts, and then I was supposed to go back out there and do the work. Well, now the guy had my phone number because I had to call him to let him know when I was going to be on my way out there. So he calls me at work, at my other job, my original full-time job, and is trying to talk to me about this. I'm like, I don't have time. I'm at work at my other job. Oh, I'm sorry, blah, 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 blah. So he does it to me again the next day. And I ignore it. And then he catches me. Well, you didn't answer my call. I told you I was working. This is my full-time job. Now I'm on my part-time job where I can call you on their time. So we hit it off. He was, you know, okay guy, this and that, talking, and he wanted me to do some side work for him. He wanted me to put slide toppers on his trailer. So I shot him a quote. I cut the quote in half because I was going to do it by myself. I wasn't going to have any additional help. I told him, I said, I would need his help for, you know, a couple of minutes to get the other side hooked on. But I told him, outside of that, I think this is my dinner. So you guys stay safe, and I will catch you later.